Thank you very much, and I feel very much honored to be here and participate in this encounter in your honor. I think the Sousa Santos, not Santos, and I feel all the more honored that my trajectory, when I think to that of a young chemist who decided to become a philosopher, did not make me anticipate to become able to be here today. In fact, but for the point that it was marked all the time and more precisely articulated by a dissatisfaction toward what is usually called science. And when I say science, it's a singular with a big S, in opposition with sciences with small s and plural. So I mean that the science, which means Western science, and also the idea behind the singular that the idea that there is some kind of a unified identity of modern Western science to be formulated by philosophers, for instance. I will thus speak about this idea and its consequences, and not directly of Global South, which was the first victim of this idea. I think that it has now its own voice, and I am not to take this voice and speak in its name. So I will speak about what I know, my experience. And I will begin by explaining that to me the very idea of a unified Western science, I mean a unified identity of which they would all participate, is not only misconceived, but also producing disasters. Certainly this idea does not disturb sciences like physics, which inspire it with power and proof, but it does not, because, okay, it's a model, but this model has catastrophic results elsewhere. I wish to say that in order to struggle against this model, it may be not sufficient to speak about, I think that you spoke about that from time to time, about contextualization. It's not so much a question of taking the context into account, because the very decontextualization is the very strategy implied by the unified model of modern science. Since it relies on the idea that the value of powers, the value of facts is to prove, it needs extraction and decontextualization. Only facts as they are extracted and decontextualized can get this power to demonstrate. Usual facts do not have it. Extracting, when you deal with experimental science, is really the soul and life of it. It's an adventure, because there the extraction is careful and must produce interesting results. I will come back on that. The point here is that as soon as we leave those experimental sciences, when we go to positive sciences in general and many social sciences, what we find is sad strategies, sad performing of the model, dismembering, breaking down situation which become meaningless in order to define what matters, which is the fact to be used as a proof. I will not give many examples, we can come back along the discussion, but we can think about psychological laboratory where the main point is to get for the scientist often to keep the mastery of the situation. He is the one, she also, is the one who is asking the question. No negotiation about the meaning and aim of their questions and what compliance is required. In fact, you all know about Milgram experience, where the experimenter was able to fabricate tortures. Well, this is, in fact, what is presupposed by this kind of methodology. Obey and do not discuss. I know what I am doing. And other strong cases may be offered by in the field of curative practices, where all the methodology is meant to isolate and extract facts which permit to judge the efficacy, the purified efficacy of a molecule, for instance. So it means judging away all the art of the healer, as if from that point of view, all healers, from traditional healers to the last of the charlatan, was to be judged as doing the same thing, benefiting the famous placebo effect, you know. So those are strategies which look like science, but in fact function, perform the dismembering and the destroying of the meaning of situation for all other people concerned by this situation. And here, so cognitive injustice is implied right from the beginning with the idea of the one who extracts. I know what matters, you don't. You are attached to appearances or to beliefs. So my questions, given the formidable inequality between the effect of this idea of a unique model, my question was how to understand the performance of this model. How to understand that this idea of a unified model that is so robust, why it is a disaster. And if, in fact, it is not a disaster for all the protagonists in the modern scene. I would propose to approach the question starting with the idea of symbiosis. Symbiosis, you know, the way two protagonists with diverging interests are related because they need each other to satisfy those interests. And for what concerns experimental science, it's well known. The symbiosis was first with technique and then with industry, which included technique and capitalism accumulation. And there you find indeed diverging interests, because if experimental scientists are interested in extracting and preparing facts that prove novel facts with very definite meaning for them, well, those who use those facts, who have a use for those facts, are not interested in the proof. They are interested in the possibilities opened by the facts. They are interested by performing the possibility as they are identified with experimental science. So each, there is a symbiosis which, I will come back on that, is now turning into a capture, since now those sciences are asked for innovation, not understanding, not interesting facts, but innovation at any price. It's called the economy, the knowledge economy. But here we find, in this symbiosis, we find the beginning of a very strong cognitive injustice. Because, in fact, when you consider experimental science, you have to consider how the facts and the extracted product, innovative extracted product, travel. They can travel along laboratory ways, a whole network of laboratories. Here we have a very special kind of universality because anywhere where the same decontextualizing strategy are performed, you get the same facts. So it's conserved. But conserving, it does not mean it rules the situation, but it can be recreated in any kind of situation which has been the conditions of culture, I would say, culture of the fact. But in other case, the laboratory product is meant to be released out of the control scene. And it was the case for the genetically modified organisms, plants. And there, in fact, I mean, the reliability of knowledge extracted is no longer wanted, but because all the questions which were eliminated in order to extract are waiting at the door of the lab. So, in fact, in this case, those organisms are said to be scientific by cognitive injustice, because the voices of those who are concerned with those differences, who know about the difference between the land and the field, and the economic power relation around the fields and the agriculture, are muted. I will come back on that, but indeed, here we understand that as soon as a lab product leaves the place, the lab purified controlling places, we see a cognitive injustice because the voices who would say pay attention to the consequences you cannot predict are killjoy, sportsmen, intruders. Let us modernize together. We will see. It's not probable. All the defensive, diminishing the contrast between in the lab and out the lab gets get power. And what is the difference between in the lab and out the lab? Well, it has been well characterized by Anat Singh in her now famous A Mushroom at the End of the World. It's scalability. In the lab, you have scalable fact, which can be of use whatever the scale. I mean, it can be scaled up. It can travel in different conditions. While the entanglements, which are important, relevant in the field, are not scalable. So they cannot add to general knowledge. You have to be interested in a long time for the way of the agriculture, for the way of the economy, for all that thing, to begin thinking about in a relevant way about how can GMO matter. Or you can listen to voices telling about it. So there is already here around those experimental sciences, which are successful sciences, there is always cognitive injustice because all facts are not the same value. There are scalable facts which have the power of proving, and you have facts in the field, meaning the field in general way, which are not scalable and which demand for attention, for care, and for hearing diverging concerns. So, but the second symbiosis, I would speak very quickly because you know it well, in fact. The second symbiosis is with a very different protagonist. These protagonists, let's say, state powers, are interested in protecting public order. And I would say, when I got to know many social sciences, mainstream social sciences, I discovered that far from following the model of experimental sciences, meant for them finding the illusory category of many things people are concerned with, and weakening them, which means also muting public anxiety, or public unrest, or public dissatisfaction of complaints, meaning protecting public order. And very often, statistics about risk and all that are used in a way such that, in fact, the anxiety or the complaints, for instance, today it's about the effect of electromagnetic waves, are dealt with as if they were suspect. It's polemic. They have to proof against the hypothesis that it is only illusory. They are not characterized as such positively. No, they are tested against the idea, which would be the normal issue, that it's only illusions. So there is a strategy in social sciences which is bearer and performer of social injustice, cognitive injustice. Complaints are a priori wrong. So, but it's the same. It's the same strategy as the other one, extracting facts. But the effect is very different. Is very different because there, the idea of the extraction is to mute other voices. Why, in the first case, for instance, the GMO, well, scientists were not even thinking about muting voices. They were just not anticipating them. They were so indoctrinated by the idea that they were participating in the protest of agriculture that those voices had to be misled. It is two ways of minding what you do and minding the injustice you perform, which are both unjust. But I think it's worth noting that they are distinct. That many social scientists firmly think that what their task is to debunk illusions and irrationality, while positive scientists, experimental scientists, do not even think of that. They have no imagination. The belief in the progress of modernization will bring. And it's important to know the difference because if you remember, because it makes a difference in the way you address those scientists. I don't know how to address social scientists to tell you the social scientists. I mean debunking positive social scientists. I just wish to kill them, but it's not. Why I am really interested in the way to address experimental scientists and positive scientists, because they may be able of something else. They might be able. I don't know how. Yes, I think I know, but not with the same people. I don't. Other social sciences might be possible, but I don't know what could be kept from the mainstream social sciences. Why I think that other way of understanding experimental sciences could be possible without inserting with a recognition of the value of the knowledge that they produce. So, and if you remember, you know, in the 19th, it was the time of the famous scientist war, where so critical sociologists and also critical thinkers in general published the idea that sciences were social practice like any others. Well, it was not wrong. I would have said among others and not like, because I think that no practice is ever like others. Each practice needs its own way of characterization, and sociologists have no high point from which to judge a practice to be like others. But scientists were insulted. They did answer in block, and any path for doubting, for telling that maybe they ought to think about the situation was blocked, because those who would try them would be suspect of betrayal. So I think that maybe it is important to understand other ways to address them, which may make them think and not insulting in block, because they are inventive. And if their invention, their demanding character of loving facts, which are able to prove, is insulted, they will become blind and curious. What are the polite questions? I think that we should avoid things like taking seriously that there is an epistemology, because or avoid objectivity, rationality, and all that, avoid any off-ground desituating characterizations. I love performance because it emphasizes the engagement of a knowledge practice in relational situations which are not by design conceived to justify one claim against the others. Performing demands that we pay attention to the consequences of different ways of performing a situation. And from that point of view, it was a great strength of the resistance against genetically modified crops, that indeed it was its performance, the performance of such agriculture, which was contested. It was not, protesters did not need questioning the laboratory science which produced those this possibility. What they did protest again were the consequences. And those consequences, biologists just ignored them. They were surprised. If it had been told them that they had a bad epistemology, first, they would not understand the world. And second, they were not imagining anything like that. For them, the field was an extension of the lab. So they would have been insulted. But people who come and told them about all the questions which arise in the field, well, had them surprised. In fact, their experience were a bit without words in front of the situation. And they were not mobilized. They could not mobilize against people contesting the progress because they were ignoring the frame and all that. And I think that the situation has changed since this event some 20 years ago. There are scientists thinking, and there are activists not afraid of science and of analyzing, not the epistemological science, but the way science is ignored of what it is doing, which is a very much more effective way of attacking somebody, to tell you do not know what you are speaking about. That's very effective as a way of attacking. So I think that in this case, we had an interesting way of confronting those scientists. And anyway, since this GMO affair, European and national officials responsible for the governance of science have taken one decision. Never such an affair again. Everything should be done to avoid such a contestation. Well, everything, not everything, because if everything was really done, it would mean democratization of science, active implication of the concerned people in the scientific development and all that. This is not happening. It is window dressing and cosmetic indeed. But it's still the great frighten of those who defend public order that this kind of affair where scientists were taken as ignoring the consequences other people were concerned with. And I think that it's really, to me, the starting point of this idea that there is a reclaiming of science, of those science which are alive because they are inventive. There is a possibility of them reclaimed by the scientists. I love the term reclaiming because it's an activist term which means healing, both healing from a separation and reappropriating what you have been separated with. If we say that, and then in this case, a reclaiming would be reclaiming from the effect of the double symbiosis which put scientists in the service of public order and of industrial development. I think that maybe the sense of this reclaiming of this possible other sciences could be what I call demobilization. As you know, a mobilized army is an army which has to go fast. And in order to go fast, not to be disturbed by the disaster it caused on its passage, you know, the burning fields, the raped women and all that, in order to go, they have to look ahead and not to look around. That they have to be anesthetized as for the effect of their passage. So to me, mobilized is looking ahead and not around. And I think that the model of experimental science was indeed looking ahead, advancing, making science advance. And for that, they have need to extract. They have the need to extract, and the fact that they extract is as indeed for its only value to show ahead, to point towards ahead, because the only value of an experimental fact is the new facts it will make possible and the cumulative advance those facts makes possible. So looking ahead and not around is what we learn at school, at the university, when we become scientists. Killing the imagination for looking around and looking only ahead is why I left chemistry. In fact, I didn't know why, but now I understand why. And this cumulative advance is what other scientists could not reproduce. With other sciences produce so-called objective science, one page. With other sciences which just produce objective science, their image is a small brick to be added to an edifice. You don't even know the form of static edifice, one fact more. In science, you look ahead because the value is available. And in order to, so my point of reclaiming is learning to look at the world, getting this imagination and this appetite to look at the world. Reclaiming the capacity to look at the world, again, a kind of indoctrination. Science studies which tell you about progress and kill your imagination about the consequences of this progress. And for that, for this kind of reclaiming, well, and as a result of this kind of reclaiming too, it's not pure disinterested science which should happen, but a new symbiotic alliance with the concerned, with those public with whom scientists may learn about the kind of relevant intervention they may or may not propose in such and of such situation. So this is again a matter of symbiosis, but a symbiosis which those scientists would know is needed in order for what they propose to be relevant and not unreliable. So it would be indeed accepting the test of situation and concerned people, concerned by the situation people, accept the test by situation of the relevance of the what they may be able to perform. So it's really, to me, the idea of discussing science as such has not much meaning, because science exists through and because of the symbiotic alliance, and it has always operated like that. Even non-modern science exists through the symbiosis. It is part of. But the missing partner, the missing symbiotic partner, which was expelled since modern science did exist, is the public. So to me, it's really when the public in general, gets enabled to contest, and not to insult, but to contest and to open the imagination of scientists, that we can get scientists who would reclaim and reclaim the kind of education they need in order to become able to learn with concerned people. Stories more than demonstration and great story of progress. Stories of the many ways that knowledge may come to matter in different situations. Imagination, reclaiming imagination again, canalization. Thank you very much. And I